Guys, on the ship, we often get a weather fax from the weather facsimile, and the weather fax is used to get an indication of what the weather will be in the surrounding areas. And this is a good indication for us to even plan our passage and whether our passage will experience any kind of heavy weather, rough seas, or developing low pressures that may turn into tropical revolving storms. All right, so let me take you through the essential features of a weather fax and show you how we interpret information from it today. All right, so I've taken the example of Australia, and you can see the outline of the Australia on the weather fax. And let me show you with the first feature of what we can identify here. So the first feature is, of course, the title and the issue date with the validity information of the weather fax. So this is, of course, from 2003. The date is given as 1st of January. The UTC or the GMT time, as well as the Eastern Standard Time, is provided on the weather fax. The validity date is given there as well. It's an MSL analysis, which is a mean sea level analysis. And this has been issued from the National Meteorological and Oceanographic Center, Bureau of Meteorology. All right, so we'll start with the other features. So this is here is a high pressure symbol, or H, and H stands for high pressure. And the pressure is provided right below the symbol as 1024. So that is the atmospheric pressure at that point of time. The L stands for low pressure, and the low pressure is also provided right below the symbol. So wherever you see the letters H and L, they stand for high pressure and low pressure respectively, with the pressure provided right below the letter. Then we have the isobars. The isobars are lines that joins areas of equal atmospheric pressure. Also included within these lines is the pressure reading. So as you can see, where the arrow is pointing right now, it's 1012, and then we have 1016 below it, and 1008 above it. So they are separated by 4 millibars of pressure, these lines, and they join areas of equal atmospheric pressure and call isobars. Then we have the cold front. The cold front, as you can see, is denoted by those triangular features on the black line. The cold front is the leading edge of a cooler mass of air, replacing at ground level a warmer mass of air, which lies within a fairly sharp surface of low pressure. So this cold front is formed in the wake of an extratropical cyclone at the leading edge of its cold air advection pattern, which is also known as the cyclone's dry conveyor belt circulation. Temperature differences across the boundary can exceed more than 30 degrees Celsius or 54 degrees Fahrenheit from one side to the other. When enough moisture is present, rain can occur along the boundary. There could be heavy showers that last only for a short time, but heavy showers. If there is significant instability along the boundary, a narrow line of thunderstorms also form along the frontal zone. If instability is less, then a broad shield of rain can move in behind the front, which increases the temperature difference across the boundary. So cold fronts are therefore stronger in the spring seasons and weaker during the summer seasons. Then we have what is known as a trough. Now, a trough is an area of low pressure. It's basically an elongated region of relatively low pressure, often associated with fronts. So troughs may be at the surface level or aloft or both under various conditions. Now, most of these troughs, they bring along with themselves clouds, showers, shift in the wind speeds and direction. The results from convergence, which forces lifting of the moist air, occurs behind the trough line. So unlike fronts, there is not a universal symbol for a trough on a weather chart. So the weather chart in some countries or regions mark troughs by a line. In America, for example, a trough may be marked as a dashed line or a bold line. In the UK, it is represented by a bold line extending from a low pressure center. In Australia, it is a dashed line, as you can see. If they are not marked, troughs may still be identified as an extension of isobars away from a low pressure center. So a trough is not in a general term a boundary, but an elongated area of low pressure. So there are changes in wind direction across a trough, but there is no change in the air mass. So sometimes the region between two high pressure centers may also assume the character of a trough, especially when there is a detectable wind shift noted at the surface. So in the absence of a wind shift, the region is designated something called a col. If a trough forms in the mid-latitudes, a temperature difference at some distance between the two sides of the trough usually exists, and the trough might become a weather front at some point. Alright, so I'll keep going, otherwise I can talk a lot about the trough. I'll talk about the ridge now. So ridge is opposite to a trough. I think ridge is an elongated area of relatively higher pressure that extends from the center of a high pressure region. So a ridge is a region with relatively higher heights. So a broad region of sinking air or a deep warm air mass will both lead to some kind of a ridge. So since air is often sinking within a ridge, ridges are associated with warmer and drier weather, opposite to that of trough, which are associated with low pressure. Then you can see here is there is an arrow with the cold front, which indicates the direction and speed of movement of the cold front. So you can see the speed is mentioned there. If you can really focus, it's mentioned as 25 knots, so it could be 25 knots. The direction you can see is about northeasterly, sort of northeasterly direction there. Right, then we have the warm front. The warm front is denoted by the semicircular symbols opposed to the triangular symbols that denote cold front. So a warm front is a kind of a density discontinuity located at the leading edge of a homogeneous warm air mass. Warm fronts lie within broader troughs of low pressure than cold fronts. They move more slowly than the cold fronts, which usually follow because cold air is denser and less easy to remove from the Earth's surface. Now, warm fronts also force temperature difference across. So this slower movement forces temperature difference across warm fronts to be broader in scale. So therefore, clouds ahead of the warm front are mostly stratiform, and rainfall gradually increases as the front approaches. But the rainfall is sustained for a longer period of time. It is not that intense as it is, because if the warm air mass is unstable, then thunderstorms may be embedded among the clouds ahead of the front. On the weather maps, you can see that the surface location of a warm front is marked with a normally a red line of semicircles pointing in the direction of the travel. So the semicircles kind of point in the direction of the travel. Lastly, I'll show you the frontal depression. Now the frontal depression, you see, if you think about or look at it carefully, it's occurring at the boundary between two air masses, is often distorted by warmer air bulging into the colder air, with the bulge moving along like a wave. So the leading edge of the wave is known as the warm front, while the trailing edge is called a cold front, as you see on the screen as well. The cold front usually moves across the surface faster than the warm front, and the pressure near the top of the wave falls sharply and kind of a depression falls. So you can see where the warm front and the cold front are intersecting, this gap starts to become narrower and narrower, and that leads to formation of a depression or something very similar to that of a cyclone. So on your screen you can see that the frontal depression is occurring where the cold front, a separate cold front, is meeting the warm front that has been highlighted, and where they meet, that gap slowly starts to close, that leads to into formation of a kind of a cyclone. All right, so I hope this was a useful video for you guys to learn about the essential features of a weather map or of weather facts. And tomorrow, if you see one on the ship or you receive one on your ship, you can then start to learn what information you can interpret from it and then apply it to your passage plan as well. All right guys, let me know what you thought about this video. I'll see you soon with my next video. Keep studying and study hard. Bye.